everything and give.
Pardon me, sir?
I'll be stitching all the topics today. So whatever you have discussed, I have to do stitching of all the topics today.
Yeah. They can now only realize the first utilization of all these technologies.
Yes.
Individually, we are talking about advanced technologies. Today, we will know. Today onwards, we are working also. I am at college now. Your voice is not audible, sir.
Yeah, you have reached the campus itself, ma'am, today?
Yeah, we are in the campus.
Okay.
Hello. இது ஆன் பண்ணலப்பா சார்ஜ் ஆலே
கன்ஃபியூஷன் நீங்க தெளிவா இருக்கணும் எது ஃபைனல் பிளான். ஓகே, இப்போ காலையில் பண்ணிக்கலாம்.
Thank you.
சந்திரன் ஜெயசந்திரன் சார் ஜெயசந்திரன் சார்
மேம் சொல்லுங்க மேம்
ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஆஸ்க் देम டு மியூட் देयर மைக்ரோஃபோன் பார்ட்டிசிபன்ட்
எஸ் மேம்
யூ கேன் புட் இட் இன் தி சாட் சார் டு ஆர் த்ரீ டைம்ஸ் இட் யூ ரிபீட் இட் டெல்லிங் தி மியூட் ஐ திங்க் and she started it only 64 but shall we start
we can start ma'am they are coming on we can start okay. at
yeah 11 o'clock now we will start we should be am I audible sir
yes ma'am sir, but there is a little lag there but that yes, is a little lag
I am managing the cell phone now Good morning to all, and once again welcome to Ishwari College webinar series. Welcome, Mr. Sudhakar from Dimension. Welcome, sir, for yet another interesting series. All these days,
thank you, ma'am.
Most of the technologies we have covered. Now today we will see the application of all the technologies in one area. It is very very important and civil engineer point of view. In the future, all these concepts will be put in the smart housing also, not only in smart cities. Welcome, and we are all eager to hear your presentation, sir. I now request Dayachandran sir to introduce the guest so that we can start. Dayachandran sir.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning to all our participants. I warmly welcome our Dr. Sudhakar, who is the director of Dimensions in Design. And he is having 20 years of experience in the field, and he have consulted a lot of projects. Now he is taking over consultants in a smart city also, so that sir will be giving a deep idea about the smart city. So we are very familiar with the word smart city, but we don't have what it is and what will be the aspects inside the smart city and how to establish it. I think today's speech by our guest Dr. Sudhakar will be giving a wide open knowledge opening lecture. I welcome all our participants and behalf of our Ishwari Engineering College and Department of Civil Engineering. I thank to all the our faculties, our students, and our HOD ma'am for this very good opportunity to conduct this 7-day senior series of webinar. And today is our 6th day. I welcome all of you. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I will give one small announcement, sir. Participants, please pin the Dimensions CBU for your presentation. All of you, kindly mute the video and audio and pin the Dimensions CBE so that you can visible the participant presentation. Thank you, sir.
So a very very warm good morning to one and all present here. Am I audible, sir? Can I proceed?
Audible, sir. Your voice is audible.
And my screen is audible, also being shared. And you can see my screen as well, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. All right. So let me congratulate your institution for taking the pains of conducting such a serious webinar series, and I was so glad to understand the participation level, which was quite encouraging for people like us. We sometimes always feel that what's the point? We are shouting at the top of our roof, but no one is listening. But in this lockdown situation, if so many civil engineers are serious about knowing technical stuff, then it means the future for India. Should I wait till the host will mute everybody, sir?
Sir, excuse, I can't hear you, sir.
I think few people have not muted.
Yeah, now I'll proceed. So, as introduced by the organizer, as the organizer introduced, this smart city is actually a very well misunderstood concept. It is not only civil engineers who have been confused about it, it is also the administrators who have been confused about it. And originally it is more a administrator's topic and less of a civil engineer's topic. Maybe I would rate it 60-40, which means there is a lot of civil engineering into it, as you all know. Madam was just telling me that you had an insight into various high-end technologies, and I was replying her that maybe it is my duty to stitch all those high-end technologies into the smart city concept. At the outset, let me tell you, smart city is a.
Sir, very sorry to interrupt you. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
We could not see the PPT, sir. We can see your web browser only.
Is it okay?
I think you need to shift that.
Let me try, sir.
Yes.
Is it visible now, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is visible, sir. It is in full screen. Yeah. Smart city, it is visible.
Yeah. So the word smart city, though catchy it is, it doesn't mean it is a sophisticated city. First point you should all understand is smart cities need not be high-tech cities. It need not be very, very sophisticated cities. Smart cities actually are, having a lot of latest technologies integrated into them, a lot of user-friendly attributes to them. But it doesn't mean it has to be a city like what is shown in Star Trek movies or the Hollywood movies. So the first thing which you have to take away from your mind is smart cities are not high-tech cities, but smart cities are very, very functional cities. Let us see the theoretical explanation given by the Government of India. Smart cities, now as such, it's a mission undertaken by the Government of India. It is an innovative and a new initiative by Government of India to drive economic growth, which means the purpose of smart city is to drive economic growth and improve the quality of life of people. So when you are talking about smart city, before any technology comes into your mind, there should be two keywords which should come to your mind, which is economic growth of that city and the quality of life of the people or the citizens of the city, for which you can use technology, you can use old technology also. It is not that you will have to use only contemporary technology. Overall, it is a drive to ensure economic growth and quality of life. Sorry. How is it different from any other mission or design? So you might have seen many designed cities around the world. In India, Chandigarh is one of the famous designed cities. But what happens in such design? If you talk to any master of town planning, he would say, he would lay down the fundamental requirements of a new city. He would lay down the fundamental principles in which a new city should be formed, all those things. But if you observe a little bit closely, those are all focused from a execution perspective or a buildability perspective. But smart city mission is a little bit different. They always, you see the projects from the user's perspective. So if you have to design, for example, as a civil engineer, tomorrow you are given a task of designing a gated community. Any one of
ड्यूटी बैठ बता
आई बंदे होने बता
करा करते थे
इसलिए अगर लिंग फीडबैक लिंग है तो हम लोग आपको मतलब
ओके So, in case you are being given a task of just designing a gated community, say for 50 acres or 10 acres, small gated community, the civil engineer's approach would be to first survey the area, then divide that into a number of plots, then see what can fit where. This is our conventional approach, working from whole to part. But smart city ka approach is always put people first, first list down what is required and then start finding avenues or places where you can implement this. So you have to understand two important perspectives. I've told you the first one, take away the picture of high-tech city, always think about economic growth and quality of life. And second major point is you always have to put people first. It has to be designed from the end user's perspective. Nothing from the buildability and all will be checked, but the design is from the end user's perspective. It will not be from top down, it will be from bottom up. Yeah, so what does it aim apart from the two major spheres what I told you? Economic growth is a big subject in itself. It is something related to the GDP, it is something related to the finance policies of that particular state, its proximity to port, all those things. But when it comes to our domain, when it comes to a civil engineer's domain, then his duty is to design a smart city in order to give a decent quality of life, not a sophisticated quality of life, clean and sustainable environment, which means you have to talk a lot about resource management, be it the raw material resource or the fundamental resources like water supply, etc., and also the resource of the waste management and application of smart solutions, which I know you would have discussed a lot of topics like the drone technology, GIS, online monitoring systems, building information systems. These are all smart technologies which can help you to achieve the purpose of a smart city. See, in this particular PPT, I will keep it very light. I will not be teaching you any technologies. I will try to identify areas where a future civil engineer, which means ideally you are in the campus now, where you can prepare yourself so that you can get very good employment opportunities or business opportunities in the forthcoming smart cities. And to prepare your mind, you first have to make yourself confident that there is nobody called a smart city expert in this world. There cannot be a single entity which will design the smart city. In fact, smart city as an entity itself is called a special purpose vehicle. This is an economic term. It is not a civil engineering term. It is not a physical vehicle, but it is an entity created by the government, which has got a managing director whose job is only to integrate the various people, various agencies working on a smart city, which means I as a civil engineer, however qualified I am, cannot design a smart city sitting in a table. I cannot design it myself. It has to be an integration of various formats of engineering, various formats of administration, etc. So it is a team effort. It cannot be a single person's effort. Okay. What does a smart city have? The salient features, the fundamental features which any smart city should have is adequate water supply. Now, take this word itself, this domain, adequate water supply. Now, if as a civil engineer, if you start thinking deeply into it, you will find so many avenues where you will get employed. First thing is GIS. In today's scenario, Coimbatore being my city is one of the smart cities which is being under development. One important challenge for any city would be water supply management. Coimbatore is surrounded by a lot of lakes. We have the Western Ghats very nearby, which has got a lot of catchment potential areas. Now, without tapping that potential. If I start increasing the efficiency or adding more technology to the existing infrastructure what we have, then it would not mean anything to the smart city. So water supply starts from tapping the resources, which will involve a lot of GIS application, surveying application, remote sensing applications. So this is one area of employment. Naturally, I know there are at least 7 to 8 agencies working on this for Coimbatore city alone. If you look at the number of smart cities in the entire nation, you should imagine your employability potential. And I'm telling you today, even now, you'll not believe I have a resume in front of me, just reaching us today morning, hoping for some job in surveying and all. A thorough hand, a good hand in total station survey will easily fetch you somewhere around 30,000 to 35,000 rupees as salary per month. If you are very thorough, and you need not have a very, very long tenure of experience. A 6-month apprenticeship under any surveyor is adequate. A lot of people, lot of agencies working in smart city project in Coimbatore are in demand of surveying people, civil engineers who can handle total station survey per se. So we'll again jump into the salient features. Water supply, electric supply, assured electric supply. It's a 24/7 non-interrupted electric supply. Sanitation, which lays much emphasis on solid waste management. Urban mobility, which means traffic management, and public transport. Now there are two different words given here. They are not the same. Urban mobility indicates traffic management, the seamless operation of any kind of a vehicle, and public transport talks about specific models of public transport like the BRTS, bus rapid transit system, the monorail, metro rail, the light metro, whatever. So these are transportation models for public transport. So you should have both these planning in place to ensure that your city is qualified under the smart city. Affordable housing, especially for the poor, of course, it is all low income group housing, which Tamil Nadu Housing Board and Slum Clearance Board has taken giant steps in slum clearance, getting affordable housing into the picture. Now, talking about affordable housing, this again is a huge opportunity for civil engineers, because precast housing is slowly eating the market. Affordable housing is as of now being dominated by precast housing. Day by day, this dominance is growing. So a thorough knowledge on precast technologies, your precast design principles, erection principles will fetch you high earning jobs. There are already 4 major precast players who have come into the market. There is a lot of FDI, foreign direct investment, which is going to come in after post COVID era. You will have a lot of FDI coming into precast, especially. There were MNCs who were operating in precast earlier. Now again, at Krishnagiri, very near to your place, a US-based company has started operations. There is one more German-based and Malaysian-based company who is doing the preliminary survey to get into Tamil Nadu as such. So affordable housing is a very promising sector, and out of which precast housing would gain very huge prominence, and therefore will fetch you a lot of employment opportunities. Next, a smart city should have a very robust IT connectivity and digitalization. IT connectivity, everybody will know, enough bandwidth. You should have Wi-Fi enabled zones. Digitalization should be the order of the day. No more paper and pen. Your entry systems, your ticketing systems, your payment options, everything is going to be digitalized. So you will not be operating on physical currencies, or you will not be filling up physical challans for any of your requirements. This point, good governance, especially e-governance and citizen participation, though it is not belonging to civil engineering domain, it has got a lot of meaning in the whole design itself. Give me a minute. It has got a lot of meaning in the whole design itself, because good governance is one of the key parameters of smart city projects. All projects or sub projects taken under smart cities should be with a public participation model. Anybody should be able to access its data. It has to be a very transparent operation. So starting from the tender system, so the announcement of tenders itself will be so very transparent. And this is a very important feature which we all like very much, because unlike the past, many projects, special projects taken by the government of India, be it any government, will be on a specialty basis. It will be open to only few special agencies, the big giants of the corporate world. But in smart cities, you cannot have a single tender pass like that. Even to purchase a pen, it has to be very transparent. So this transparency is one encouraging factor that lot of youngsters, a lot of new honest businessmen are trying to contribute and gain out of the smart city mission. Next point is sustainable environment. We have been talking so much about environmental impact of development. We are now holding seminars and webinars on green building technology. Sustainability is the order of the day. You cannot escape it. You would have seen in the past couple of years what amount of turmoil happened in people trying to revolt against certain projects, especially the Tuticorin projects, Sterlite projects, whatever. So people are becoming more and more aware to the impact of industry or development on the environment, and therefore all smart city projects has to be on the sustainability mode. It doesn't mean we'll have to build green buildings everywhere. The designs have to be very, very responsible, so that they do not exploit the environment, or they do not create a very large footprint. So that is what is meant by this feature of sustainable environment. Safety and security of citizens is an inevitable factor that has to be a very, very important salient feature of any smart city project. Health and education. Mind you, in this health, if you look at the website, Government of India's website on smart city mission, you would be surprised. This social distancing and this quarantine, what we are talking today, has been forethought 5 years ago when this was conceived as a project. So all your public utility systems, public environment, I mean infrastructure systems, should be designed with health in the background. The social distancing, the sanitation part is a very, very important aspect of any future design in a smart city. Okay, we'll go to these features one by one. Under adequate water supply, you will have to provide clean drinking water 24/7, which is a metered water supply. You will not be given a time-bound water supply. You can get your drinking water anytime throughout the year, but it will be metered, which will demand a 24/7 maintenance team. This also has got a lot of scope for civil engineers. One, for the implementation. Second, for the plant, water supply plant to be in operation, its maintenance, and the maintenance of the system itself. There is already a Suez-based company, a France-based company called Suez, which has put up its office in Chennai as well as Coimbatore. Now the first 24/7 metered water supply is happening in two phases in Coimbatore. So you know, sooner or later you can expect a placement drive from all these majors so that they have a very good maintenance team. Electricity supply, yes, it's the conventional electricity supply what we are going to use, but more and more dependency on solar powered generation is happening. There is something called a private public partnership in solar power generation units, which means a group of entrepreneurs can come together and set up a solar power generation plant and sell it to the government or pass it on to the grid for a smart city, and thereby they will get additional benefits, or they will get their whatever they have produced, they can draw from the grid in any of their production facilities. So if I have a factory which requires electricity, but I don't have the space to produce the electricity here or put up a solar plant here, maybe I'll join with two or three entrepreneurs, find a suitable place elsewhere, and I will create a very large solar power generation unit and exchange that power generated to the grid, wherein in a different place I will produce, pass it on to the grid, and whatever I have produced, I will get it free of cost in my grid here. It's not really free of cost, there is a slight operational cost etc. involved to it, but the concept is so that you will produce, push it to the grid elsewhere, and you will draw it from the grid in the place where you require. Power saving models such as the LED lamps, LED street lamps, you might already have been witness to many such changes in your own city. The sodium vapor lamps or mercury vapor lamps are nowadays being replaced by LED street lamps, and therefore you are saving a lot of power. Emphasis now for the smart city is renewable energy, where civil engineers have got two major avenues. One is the wind energy. For your information, the German major Enercon is setting up a plant in India, in Tamil Nadu. They are Europe's number one company in wind energy generation. Now they are setting up a plant in India. That would be India's largest plant for wind energy generation. So you should imagine the employability potential there. Of course, along with civil engineers, they would require a lot of mechanical engineers and electrical engineers. But fundamentally, all the erections, the surveying which is going to happen for identifying potential areas, these are all going to be in the civil engineers' scope. Sanitation, solid waste management. I am not an expert in environmental engineering. I'm basically a structural engineer. But what I understand from my interaction with all the environmentalists for smart city project in Coimbatore is the focus is more on waste management. The government has tried umpteen number of systems, including one popular being the waste segregation at source. The government tried giving different colored dustbins to the apartments and the individual households, but still we are struggling to have this waste being segregated at the source itself. There is a lot of human intervention in waste segregation in all the waste disposal yards. So as civil engineers or as researchers, if faculty members are listening to it, there is a lot of scope for you to propose waste management systems, especially waste segregation systems, or directly waste disposal systems also, because the state of the art waste disposal systems are very, very traditional, except for incinerators and things like that, which involves a little bit of mechanization. We still depend on the time tested slow process of bacterial disintegration of the waste. If we can come up with accelerated disintegration systems, then it is going to be a huge business for you as an individual and for India to export it to the world. So I would like to draw the attention of students as well as researchers that still we are open. We have a lot of scope in waste management systems, right from the segregation. Somebody, if they can design a smart bin, meaning if in an apartment everybody throws the waste material into a single window and it automatically segregates, something like that. It might look very, very crazy or utopian for you if I tell this idea, but already some research is happening on in this line, where you have an intelligent waste management system. Very important point, urban mobility and public transport. The integrated public transport systems, why I say integrated means, I've seen in places, especially in Chennai, I take a metro, I get a ticket, come out of the metro and suddenly I feel I am in no man's land. To catch an auto, I'll have to walk another 2 kilometers. To catch any other public transport system, I'll have to take an auto and go. This is not an integrated public transport system because this is a silo operation kind of. See, unless these are well thought of and all these public transport systems are integrated, they crisscross each other, only then the efficiency of each of these transport systems will go up. Before this lockdown, my recent experience at Chennai throwed a lot of light in this. In fact, I've taken some documentation of this and I've presented it to the corporation officials here also. See, all these systems, unless they are integrated to each other or they are seamlessly stitched with each other, they have no meaning. So this is an important tip if you are taking up a project for, say, identifying potential metro rail routes. Then you should also think how to connect these rail routes with the existing bus routes also. So that's the point here. Organized cab and auto rickshaw services, you already have those in place. You have the Uber, Ola, etc., etc. But what will happen in smart city projects slowly, that all these individual brands will get integrated with a single app, so that you save a lot of fuel. See, for example, I am a pro Uber guy. I want to travel in Uber. So my natural tendency would be to download Uber app in my smartphone and try to browse for Uber auto rickshaws or Uber cabs around me. But probably an Ola cab might be a few meters away from you, which you might miss out. So what this integrated app will do is it will identify all the service providers and suggest you the nearest service provider, so that you will save on time as well as a nation we save so much on fuel, because in many a case your pickup cab comes empty for almost 7-8 kilometers. Then smart cards for public transport, I already told you we are going to move from a currency based economy to a e-currency based economy. So smart cards would be used to buy tickets for public transport. Separate cycle lanes to promote green transport. There could be cycle lanes or battery cycle lanes also. But this, for information, it flopped in Coimbatore. These are all because these are all different issues other than the technical. These are all psychology issues, social issues. Whatever cycle, green cycle, which were introduced in Coimbatore, were subject to a lot of theft, and eventually the company had to lock down and evacuate the market. So there are a lot of other awareness campaigns which are to be conducted. There has to be a lot of monitoring systems. There has to be a public policing kind of a model, where if you find somebody misbehaving, people should be bold enough to go to them and stop them. So unless this culture sets in, the concept of green cities will not achieve its complete aim. So automated signals, you already have these, but it is set for yet another slab of improvement. Signals, the signal car timing will not be preset. It will be automated. It will sense the traffic density and it will adjust the signal timings. That is the upcoming feature which is going to be added to all traffic signals in Tamil Nadu. Pedestrian walkways and crossings, flyovers, etc. These are all some of the features. Affordable housing. Yes, we have to talk a lot on this, but in a separate sector, because affordable housing has got a vertical called the financial vertical. So you'll have to understand funding models, you have to understand the cash flow models, you'll have to understand the repayment models, etc. So that is one domain. A lot of civil engineers are being recruited to be the appraisers for such housing projects. So they will have to do the project finance control. So project finance control for affordable housing is one vertical. The technology part of affordable housing is another vertical. And the maintenance part of affordable housing is another vertical. So finance, implementation and maintenance, these are the three major verticals of affordable housing as far as a civil engineer can view his employability through. So slum clearance board has come up with a lot of ideas, but one or two ideas has backfired. In few places where the slum clearance board had tried to create multi-storied apartment for in place of slums, there is again an attitude issue, a cultural issue. People who are used to sleeping on the roadside, or even if they have a, in slums, if you see, it's a typical behavior. They will have a camp cot. They would like to sleep in front of their house. So this attitude, if you have such a group and you suddenly put them on the 20th floor of an apartment, you are actually putting them into a lot of stress. Yeah, I'm not saying they are at fault. The designer is at fault. So you know, the designs have to be in line with the vibes of the population who is going to move inside such slum clearance projects. Hygiene in such projects is also a challenge. You will have to do a lot of education, a lot of maintenance, a lot of awareness, because we have seen a lot of projects where all the PVC downtake pipes are stolen before the project is put into use. So these are very, very funny points, but these are very important points in such projects. Mostly you should have ducts which will carry all these downtake pipes. These ducts should be securely locked off, or you should think of concealed plumbing systems, many, many things like that. IT connectivity and digitalization, which is an order of the day. Even without announcing some area as a smart city, today you go to any remote village of the country, the first thing you do after getting down is check whether you are getting a 4G connection or a 5G connection there. So today's public cannot live without a robust IT connectivity. The term robust is very, very important. Robust is, even if some small part of the entire connectivity chain is affected, the chain should, the IT infrastructure still should function without affecting a large part of the city. Maybe you can have pockets where you have drop downs in broad bandwidth, etc. But majorityly, it should be robust so that any small problem should not precipitate for the entire city. You will soon be having separate apps for the city itself. Now you have separate newspapers for the city. For example, you have Chennai Times, we have Kovai Times. So it will all be digitalized, and you will have authentic information available. Now you have this COVID app. COVID app is one such example. So you will have many, many features in apps like this. That is why probably the government is insisting all of us to install this government app as a mandatory requirement for few of the projects. Interaction with city officials for government and governance and grievance redressal. This is also going to be very important, not a civil engineer's domain though, but human interaction is going to be very, very minimal. So you will be facing a lot of e-way systems for applications. Already in cities like Chennai and Coimbatore, even to get a building approval, you will not have to go in person. You have an auto DCR, auto development control rules, through which you will only make a soft copy in a particular format. It is the computer which checks the requirements of the local bylaws. It is not a single person. So therefore, the governance also will become a very transparent governance. You will not have scope for corruption in the future. And this is emphasized by the salient feature called good governance and e-governance. The basic idea of this e-governance is to empower the citizen. So the citizen will have all rights to know what his application status is, why it is being rejected, and he will have a definite timeline. I already have witnessed such a beautiful rule. I was fortunate in visiting this Amaravati project, which is going to be the new capital. This is the de facto capital of Andhra Pradesh now. Now it is under construction. It is being promoted now, where if an entrepreneur or a company or an individual applies for an approval, for a building approval, and if within 15 days, 2 weeks from the date of submission of the application, if he is not getting a rejection or a suitable information from the concerned department, it is deemed that the project is approved. So the see the empowerment of citizen there. So this will be the order of the day for all the smart city projects. Another important aspect would be neighborhood councils. This will be the decentralization of certain administrative sectors of the local administration even. Now for example, the corporation of a particular city, smart city, decides to divide that into 7 or 8 zones. These zonal officers will take a call on the technology to be adopted for that particular zone. Because nowadays what happens is one technology is adopted for the entire city or the corporation, wherein some neighborhoods would have a different kind of a requirement. For example, in Coimbatore, we have a place called Ganapati, which is an industrial area. We have a place called Selvapuram, which houses a lot of dyeing units and also jewelry making units. So the kind of effluent coming from Ganapati and the kind of effluent coming from the Selvapuram is totally different. But we take everything together and process it as a single effluent. Now, instead, if you think of decentralizing, if you have neighborhood councils which will manage the waste management in particular zones, then it is going to be more efficient. So the aim is that decentralizing of decision making powers, so that the decisions are very local and it is very, very apt to that local environment. Similarly, you will have community councils as well. Sustainability, yes, sustainability is going to be having a lot of emphasis. It doesn't mean you will have to make only eco-friendly products for all the constructions. No. See, for example, people, I've seen student projects coming like that, making stabilized earth blocks as an option for pedestrian curbs, but which is practically not feasible. See, you'll have to think of the feasibility also. Though it is eco-friendly, imagine an accident effect there. Imagine an overloading effect there. So these things we cannot be sacrificed. So what I'm trying to say here is, it is not that every single brick you are going to use for a smart city project has to be a green brick. You will use appropriate technology rather than green technology everywhere. So if you use appropriate technology itself, the element of sustainability comes inside. So you will use very energy efficient systems in many areas. Like for example, if you have to create pedestrian walkways around a park, that could be out of eco-friendly material, but not the median of a state highway, which is prone to accidents, impacts, so many other things. So you will have to use appropriate technology for the right kind of application. You should be using more of recycled materials. Yes, many governments and corporations are thinking of this construction debris recycling in a major scale. Already there is a successful model running in New Delhi. Many corporations are trying to copy that, but which will involve again certain customization which will suit to local needs. Already we can see lot of research happening on recycled aggregates. There are many projects which are being implemented right now in smart cities using recycled aggregates. Sustainable agriculture, people are have already graduated, lot of farmers have already graduated to drip irrigation system. Now even drip irrigation system is going with an online sensor based modeling system. Even the drip will not be dripping all the time. It will sense the requirement of the plant and then it will open up the drip. So these are some of the advanced technologies which are coming even inside agriculture. Safety and security of citizens, of course, it is through very vigorous surveillance. Chennai is the pioneer. I think the best city in India to be kind of covered under surveillance is Chennai. Next is Pune, and then comes Mumbai. So surveillance is a major sector. You might be wondering how civil engineers would be involved in surveillance. Of course, we will not be involved in establishing or installing the surveillance systems. But what is important for us to know is, or any new system what you are going to design should also have a surveillance circuit. I've seen lot of government buildings, public utility buildings, even in the metros, in few of the metros, you can see all these cameras protruding out and you can see the wires being suspended outside the walls, which anybody will know this is the CCTV camera wire and anybody can disconnect it. The whole purpose of vigilance goes for a toss. So if you are designing public systems, if you are designing apartments, then apart from the electrical drawing, plumbing drawing, you should also have the utility drawing for the CCTV systems or the surveillance systems. You also have these surveillance system also help in energy conservation in many countries. Especially I've seen this in Ahmedabad, in few major roads, the street lights have a sensor with a surveillance system. They are switched on only when you have a vehicle coming in the proximity, so that you can save a lot of power. This is being integrated into building systems as well. A lot of automation as a sector, building automation as a sector is growing. So sensor based systems are there. There is a mood lighting system. So the sensors sense your mood, the ambient temperature, and gives you a lighting concept according to the requirement. So these are all areas where we as civil engineers have to sharpen our knowledge and find avenues of implementation and employability. Healthcare and education. Healthcare is being given more and more prominence for smart cities. Educations, I have not seen any paradigm shift in the concept, except for this COVID period. We are talking about e-based learning systems. Otherwise, there is a slow progress in the education side, I would say, as far as smart cities are concerned. I'm not saying there is zero work. Now the preliminary work is being done. People are already talking about accreditation in terms of outcome based education systems. So we are slowly moving out of classrooms. Classroom-less education systems inside the campus is also an order of the day. We have designed a whole campus, an educational campus with three schools and a technical institution, with the concept like, why should classrooms be rooms? That is the concept. A classroom need not be a room. So with that, we have designed educational campuses, which slowly will penetrate the market. People are more alert and okay to adopt these technologies, and therefore I would urge you students to study more on contemporary planning practices, especially in terms of public places like parks, malls, theaters, etc., and also institutional buildings like colleges and schools. Building information systems, not the least. I'm sure most of the colleges have the smart buildings as one of the electives, but I was also a teacher for some time, so I've been handling this. But I should confess, this was taught as a science only. For example, you say sensor, you say actuator. We talk only about the principles of operation of sensor and actuator. What I would urge is we should be talking more about the application part of sensors and actuators, or any automation system for that matter. Today is the day of online monitoring of structures. We have the classic example of Palmen Bridge now being augmented with an online monitoring system for corrosion of its piers. We have IoT application everywhere. Some of the modern bridges of the world, even the Secretariat building, now turned into a hospital, has got a lot of online monitoring systems. The airport, we have been seeing a lot of news that the roof panels, the glass panels are crashing in Chennai Airport, all these things, purely due to expansion properties of the glass and the suitable connection methodologies which were not used there. But now what they are doing is they are having a very robust monitoring system. Nowadays you see this news vanishing off. It is not that they are trying to hide the news. Nowadays this is not happening because they are able to identify the potentially crashable panes, and they are able to take suitable precautionary measures. So overall, these are the features with regard to any smart city. The funda being the economic growth and people-oriented approach. Now, on a people-oriented approach, if I am an entrepreneur already venturing into any of the smart city project, I should be taking care of all these features what I have explained now, and always try to have a user-friendly approach or the people-first approach. As a civil engineer seeking employment, again, these salient features gives us a lot of clue where I should equip myself. The major being the GIS and the total station application, or the e-survey, I would say. So it is not the conventional dumpy level or theodolite which you are supposed to use anymore. So it's more an electronic survey. So electronic survey is a major field. Waste disposal system is a major field. Building automation system is a major field. Building information system, especially softwares like Revit, integrated with Primaware or any of the project scheduling softwares. These are all major advantages. If you prepare yourself on these lines with the smart city mission in progress, we are very sure that it is not going to end with 50 cities or 100 cities in India. It is going to expand, and probably India would be mentoring other nations in this region to implement a smart city. You might all be wondering, if I study this and do some work in India, how do I get a overseas opportunity? Believe me, I became an entrepreneur with such opportunity only. I was working in a corporate, and it so happened that one of the dairy majors of India, Amul India, is the mentoring agency for few dairy based products in other countries, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, etc. So these experts will monitor the establishment and functioning of those dairy farms abroad. So in that process, I as a civil engineer got a opportunity to design projects abroad. So this is how you can also spread your footprint outside India. So you just have to sharpen your informations and your skills in very few. It is not that you will have to be an expert in the entire domain of civil engineering. You can have narrow specialization. It is no longer wrong. We have beautiful openings for skilled draftsmen, not only in terms of smart city, outside the domain of smart city also, any skilled draftsman, be it architectural or structural, you have a lot of lucrative job openings. I am again emphasizing on surveying, building information systems, waste management, and project cost control. The quantity surveying, QA and QS is another segment which is growing. Finally, you will have the repair and rehabilitation, which will involve a lot of monitoring. You will have to be, if you are a maintenance engineer, it is not that you will always be doing repairs. You will be dealing with a lot of instrumentation through which you will have to monitor the health and the performance and the serviceability of structures. So this is what a civil engineer has got in his plate when you look at smart city as a mission for India. I should confess, I am not a smart city expert. I am working for few architects in some of the smart city based projects, and I don't think it is a 100% civil engineer's domain to control a smart city. But yes, I see the civil engineers being the most benefited out of any smart city mission project. And if you are smart enough to sense that future opportunity, and if you can equip yourself to some of the demands of the future, you will have a very, very professionally satisfying and lucrative future. I think with this, I will conclude my session, and I'm open for questions now.
Thank you for your valuable session, sir. First question, shall I ask? I have a few doubts in this smart city related with the society.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in the name of a smart city and clean city in Chennai, I will make a representation as a Chennai. Lot of people who are working class people, so that is daily wagers, housekeepers, waste management people, sanitary workers are coming from a distance of 30 to 35 kilometers. That is, they are actual residents of Chennai. That is, we may say it is a North Chennai and slum areas. But now, in the name of the purifying or cleaning city or enhancement in the city or making green in the city, and a lot of spaces are made into parks, recreational clubs like that. So they are shifted to Siruseri, which is nearly 25 to 30 kilometers away from the heart of the city, and Siriperumbatore, and away from the exact city. And in Chennai, we are having a lot of buses for them. But the traveling time, therefore, 2.5 hours to 3 hours it will take to and fro. And they have to work for 12 to 15 hours. And what is the solution for this?
That is why, see, all these have been thought of and already put under the framework of the Smart City Mission. The problem with our administrators is they are not utilizing the principles properly. See, as I was mentioning in this slide, you will see neighborhood councils and community councils. See, the entire process or the entire theme says that you should not be centralizing any of the systems. You, as far as possible, decentralize. Probably people of Sriperumbudur should be employed to maintain Sriperumbudur. not people from any other part traveling all the way, as you said, 30-40 kilometers. It is waste of productivity, waste of fuel. So unless we graduate to the level of neighborhood councils with decentralized powers, this will not be achieved. But government knows that these are some of the initial shortcomings we will be facing. Sooner or later, this will be taken away. This will be decentralized, and probably they will be resituated more locally, sir. And this is how many smart cities outside India it has happened. They start like this, and slowly the system will be refined, and it will be brought to a sustainable model.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. There are many questions, sir, in the comment section. I will read them, sir.
Yes, sir.
It is from Gokul Krishnan. There is a lot of tonnage of waste disposals in Chennai. In a smart city technology, is there anything to do with that?
As I told you, there is not a major technological advancement except for incinerators, what we have, sir. I think we as a country itself, we are still lagging in smart utilization of waste. That is why I was urging researchers and students to attempt something on waste segregation technologies or waste disintegration technologies. We should accept the fact that we have not advanced much. We are still in the old rule book only.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Participants, if you are having any doubt, you can converse it with our guest. Mr. Sendamil, sir, you can unmute and ask your question. So I will read out, sir. They are not coming to the audio.
Sure.
Dr. Madan, apart from regular solid waste in cities, now we have new kind of waste from COVID hospitals and patients, like PPE, masks, a lot more. How to handle it?
I'm the wrong person to answer this, sir, but with my little interaction with the Rotaries here, especially in Coimbatore, what they do is they have set up a special plant, a special yard to treat this. I am not sure about the technology which is going behind it. I think basically it will be in regarding to the spread of the contamination. Maybe it will be in sealed concrete bins what they have developed. I don't think there is a methodology other than incineration what they will employ here. The key word maybe is to carefully segregate such waste and dispose them off in a separate yard rather than processing them with the usual waste. Maybe any environmental expert in this group should be able to answer this.
One more question from Sindham, sir. What will be the cost for implementing this smart cities, and what will be the return of this, and what is the whether it will increases the life of cost of living?
It will definitely not increase the cost of living. It's a very good question. This was one major question thrown by all panelists when smart city was as a project was debated itself. The cost of living will definitely reduce, which means the cost of public management systems will definitely reduce if and only if the advantages of the implementation of smart city is harnessed locally. For example, if you have integrated metro and road system, etc., the transport cost for a regular commuter to office might come down. See, for example, instead of taking his own vehicle which doesn't have a proper rail or a road connectivity, he might partially use a combination of the metro and the road system if it is seamless and well integrated. Now, as a result, his cost of transportation will come down for an individual. But looking at the government's perspective, instead of this guy taking his own vehicle and consuming only the fuel, he will be using a public transport system, as a result of which the government's local revenue is going to increase. But if this revenue is going to be siphoned off elsewhere, then there is no great advantage. If this revenue is being reutilized or repumped into the system locally, and which is one of the key points for smart cities, so whatever is the revenue generation will be repumped into the system, so that the local ambience is kept clean and healthy. So it is both ways a win-win situation. The cost of living will not go up. Of course, cost of implementation is there, which is now being funded by the government. So this is the order of the day. You will have to bear the cost. So there is no threat that cost of living will go up. Cost of living will come down in smart cities.
I think all the participants have got a lot of ideas about the smart city. I think I want to thank our guest, Dr. Sudhakar.
Sir, Sendamal only speaking, sir. Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Sir, actually, you told about that slum clearance, no, sir. If we are implementing the project of considering in vertical expansion, means many of the people will not afford vertical like apartments, like that they will not afford, sir.
Yes.
So, what is the alternate plan for them to accommodate in concrete houses or well-built houses, sir?
Yeah, nowadays we are talking about cluster housing, cluster communities. We are trying to copy something like the Samatvapurams. This all will be G+1 or ground floor, depending upon the population density of that city.
Land requirements, sir, whether there is that much availability of land is there to accommodate that much?
Yeah, it is available. There are lot of lands which are called Bima lands, which is there lying unutilized in many cities. These lands are not being utilized, maybe because of some political motives behind it. Maybe some politician is eyeing for some. Otherwise, land is available. Nowadays, people have started bringing that into the awareness levels. And I already see townships which are created in such kind of lands.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, thank you for your presentation, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
I think
I would like to submit my honest thanks to Ishwari Engineering College. In fact, I wanted to talk something on IoT, Internet of Things, for civil engineers, but it was some of your faculty had attended my smart city related talk for KSR Engineering College. So it is from there I have been pulled into this smart city as a topic. I would like to confess here, I am not a smart city expert. So if at all there is any lack of information, I am sorry for it. There are enough information available from a single website, which is the Government of India. You type smart city Government of India, you get a website which has got A to Z of smart city. Whatever I have talked here, you will, with this background, if you go into the website, you will be able to understand it better.
So thank you for our kind information about this, sir. Thank you for the presentation, and you have allotted your valuable time to discuss about this with our upcoming students and faculty, sir. I think a smart city will be a ruling hereafter in every towns and small villages also, so that all the our people, that is we people, civil engineers, are going to frame all these things, because we are the fundamental engineers for facilitating the other engineers, so that we for us, I think in future we will be using this for our ideas or implementing some other things. They're definitely, all our people will be working in any one of this smart city thing. Yes,
we should be talking as a smart country henceforth, not smart cities. We should try to change the whole nation.
Of course, sir. Because everybody is idea on their purpose is also to do that. That is, their village should be a smart village. Yes, contribution. Right. Yes, sir. Thank you. Nice session, sir.
Thank you
for your valuable time, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Participants, thank you for the participation, and the feedback link is available in the comment session so that you can fill your feedback. And today's afternoon session will be at 4 o'clock. Project scheduling, so that an expert in the project scheduling, and he will be explaining the software, so that I request all of you to participate. And this session is on live, so that the other people who could not able to participate in the meeting can able to come to the YouTube link, and the YouTube link will be posted soon. Thank you.